Everyone is chasing this, the 2024 Kia Telluride. And even in a class with some big names like the Honda Pilot and the Toyota Highlander, it's the Telluride that's generally considered the class of the three-row SUV world. So why is that? And what's new for 2024 that's got all of its competition chasing the Telluride's coattails? That's what we're here to find out. Kia actually refreshed the Telluride in 2023. So a lot of these changes that we'll talk about today actually happened last year, like the exterior design, which you can tell is just a little bit more sculpted than the earliest models. But in 2023, Kia did away with one of its most popular design features, and that was an amber daytime running light box around the headlamps. But there was so much backlash from fans that Kia actually brought it back for 2024. Well, kind of. These two blades just below the headlamps are the daytime running lights, and they now light up in an amber glow. So you get kind of the same feel as that original box, although it doesn't really have the same effect. Personally, if I had to rank them, I still prefer the earlier box design, and then these amber lights, and then the 2023 look. But let us know what you think in the comments. Did Kia make the right move by bringing back these amber lights? The only other notable change for 2024 is Kia changed the color of this surrounding grille and some of these exterior accents from kind of a gray metal to this glossy black finish. Otherwise, this car is pretty much the same as the 2023 model. Now, in that year, the Telluride introduced some new trim levels, and this is one of them. This is the top of the line SX Prestige, and it's got an X-Line package with some extra goodies on top. One of the secrets of the Telluride is even though it's a soft family crossover, it looks big and tough and strong, and the X-Line package helps with that. The Telluride gets 18-inch wheels as standard, but on the X-Line, you get these cool-looking 20-inch wheels, and it's got a small, like maybe half-inch suspension lift, just to give it a little bit of extra muscle. But it's not all for show, because the X-Line also comes standard with all-wheel drive and an enhanced traction control system. At the business end of the Telluride, there are a few things that make this SUV pretty functional. First of all, on the X-Line, you get raised roof rails up here compared to the normal roof rails on other models. You also get a smart power lift gate where if you have the key in your pocket and you're just standing near the back, the hatch will open. Max towing capacity is 5,000 pounds on the Telluride, but there is a way to increase it. Instead of getting the X-Line package, you can get the X-Pro package. With that, you get all-terrain tires and the towing capacity increases to 5,500 pounds. Now that gives the Telluride an edge in the class. Every Telluride has one powertrain option, and it's this V6 engine. It's a 3.8 liter and it's making 291 horsepower. Now that is a lot of power for a base engine in this class. A lot of competitors use a turbocharged four cylinder, but Kia is sticking with the good old fashioned V6, and I think buyers are rewarded for it. Now the engine sends power through an 8-speed automatic transmission. Front wheel drive is standard, all wheel drive is optional, but this baby, remember, is the SX Prestige, so all-wheel drive comes standard. The trade-off for that power is fuel efficiency. The EPA estimates the 2024 Telluride at 22 mpg combined with front-wheel drive or 20 mpg combined with all-wheel drive. Now, those are kind of low numbers for the class. Most competitors offer a more economical version if you want to boost your MPGs. So maybe it's got a smaller engine, or Mazda even offers a plug-in hybrid version of their three-row SUV. The Telluride doesn't do that. Everyone gets the same V6. But new for 2024, Kia launched the EV9 electric three-row SUV. So if you really want to cut down on gas, maybe take a look at that. Where Kia and the Telluride have really made their reputation is in the value you get for the money. The 2024 Telluride starts at about $37,000, including the destination charge. Now, that may not sound like a low starting price, but for the class, it is on the lower end compared to the Pilot and Mazda CX-90 and Toyota Highlander. The other affordable starting price I'd point you to is the Volkswagen Atlas. Now they're all pretty close, but considering the amount of features that you get with a Telluride, that's a really strong selling point. There are lots of different versions of the Telluride that you can get with starting prices all the way up through the 40s. This one, the SX Prestige, starts at a little over 52 grand, and add on all the extra goodies. In this one, it's a little over $54,000. Inside the 2024 Telluride, and with one look, you should be able to immediately see the difference that separates the Telluride from some of its other rivals. We're talking about things like this wood finish on the dash, these metal accents that run all the way through the inside of the cabin, these cool looking slim kind of athletic grab handles. And even when there is plastic that is a little bit cheap or hard to the touch, it's disguised, it's hidden among soft touch surfaces and other materials. Just a really elegant look and nice fit and finish for a three-row SUV at this price. Now, as for features, every Telluride comes with dual zone automatic climate control, which is a great feature to have. Most trims get a wireless smartphone charging station, and you can get leather seats with heating and ventilation on the mid-level EX trim. You don't have to go all the way up to the very top of the lineup. The EX is kind of a volume trim, but you still get that level of premium feel. Now on this one, the SX Prestige, you get an upgraded leather material on the seats, and the seats feel great. Nice big bolsters to hold you in place and soft, cushy padding all around. When we talk about value and an upscale feel for the price, this is the kind of stuff we're talking about. What about screens? Obviously, screens are a very prominent feature in the 2024 Telluride. Every Telluride comes with a 12.3-inch center touchscreen. The screen looks great with a really high resolution, nice color contrast, and it just looks and feels modern. Navigation is also standard on every Telluride, which is pretty rare these days. And the map is easy to use and nice and simple to follow. If you want to use smartphone integration, Apple CarPlay and Android Auto come standard. They are both wired though, not wireless like some competitors in the class. Most trim levels come with a small display in front of the driver, but if you move up to the SX, which is near the top of the lineup, you get a 12.3-inch screen. So now you've got matching screens under one nice piece of glass, which looks really clutch. Once again, these graphics are really strong, clear, and easy to find information. This particular car also has a heads-up display, and one cool feature that we'll really get into when we get on the road is a blind spot monitor. So whenever you flick on your turn signals, it's going to give you a view right in front of the driver of your blind spot, which is super helpful. I wish these features were on every Telluride. Unfortunately, these ones are only on the higher trims. Now, in a big vehicle, it's really important to have good visibility, obviously, and the Telluride has some tricks up its sleeve. First up is a rearview mirror camera, which you can flip to activate and flip to make it go back to regular old mirror. There are also lots of surround view cameras on this particular model. So if we click this button here, first we go to the rearview camera, which is pretty good resolution, but the neat thing is all the different views you can do, like this top-down look from the back, and there's some different views you can use for other looks. Now we're in the back of the Telluride, and the base models come with seating for 8 people. So that means a second row bench right here. But as you can see, these are independent captain's chairs, which are, once again, very comfortable. I also like how there's lots of space in here. For a third row, that can sometimes leave the second row a little bit cramped, but that's not the case. I've got lots of leg room behind my normal driving position, and there's tons of headroom, even though the chair is elevated here in the second row. This is really smart packaging from Kia to create all this space and still have room for 7 or 8 people. Now, when you start to look around for different features back here, at first it doesn't look like there's very much, but they're kind of spread out. For instance, rear passengers do get their own climate controls on some trims. They're just up here. So are the fans. Rear passengers also get their own USB charging ports. They're just up here on the seats. And if your trim is super cool, you also get heated and ventilated second row seats just up here on the door. You add some window shades to the mix, and it's starting to get easy to see why the Telluride is so highly valued. To get into the third row, there are a couple of different ways to fold down this second row seat. There's a button that makes it go all the way flat, or you can press this button up here to slide it out of the way. Once you're back here, the quarters are a little tight for a 6-foot-tall adult, but this seat is all the way back, and my legs are a little scrunched, but this should be perfect for kids. There's not a whole lot back here in the way of luxury or creature comforts. You do get a USB-C port on either side on this particular car. And the dual sunroof that comes on higher models of the Telluride means that your third row passengers get a really nice view of the sky to not feel too claustrophobic. Again, smart packaging and design from Kia. Lots to like about the cargo area in the 2024 Telluride. First of all, this is a big ol' opening. The lip floor is a little bit high off the ground, but there's no lip really, just these guards so you can slide heavy stuff right in. Now the third row seats are in their reclined position right now in case your third graders really need to relax after a hard day at school. But if you need max room back here, they will go up a little bit. And this creates the full maximum cargo space behind the third row of 21 cubic feet even, which is really good for the class. In the Toyota, you have to move up from the Highlander to the Grand Highlander to get in even in the ballpark of this kind of space. This is more than the Atlas, more than the Pilot, and way more than the Mazda CX-90. If you want to open up space even further, you just pull these and push the seats down. And as you can see, it creates a fully flat load floor. To get even more, there are power buttons up here to fold down the second row seats. On top of that, there's underfloor storage too, and this particular car has a cargo cover stowed away in here, which is really nice. Now, some competitors have this stuff too, but the way that the Telluride packages it is super convenient and really maximizes its interior space. Another win for the Telluride. Behind the wheel of the 2024 Telluride, and right off the bat, the main feature of this car on the road is its big, cushy ride comfort. Everything about the driving experience in this car is built around making it feel like a plush and luxurious ride. Now, this is a large vehicle and it feels it pretty much all the time. It's got really big, broad hood line, and same with the shoulder line too, which starts up pretty high. So you've got to be aware of its size at all times. But what really helps is the ease with which you can drive it. The steering effort isn't very high, the brakes respond really well, and of course, there's plenty of power from that 291 horsepower V6 engine. Now, other competitors in this class are more agile or more responsive or feel more direct. Some of them use electrified power to give you quick little bursts or really smooth power delivery. This is just old school, big size, nice, cushy ride. There's nothing super fancy about the way the Telluride drives, but there is a lot that's really enjoyable. The defining feature of this engine is pretty smooth, linear power delivery. Quick stabs of the throttle don't really deliver a lot. You can get a nice big burst if you really lay into it, but this is for cruising. And same with the transmission. Now, I've been pretty critical of Kia's 8-speed automatic in the past, and I have some of the same gripes here. Like just from the start in the lower gears while it's getting up to speed, it can just be a little abrupt, a little jerky sometimes. But with the Telluride, it all seems to smooth out. Feels like it all gets lost in the wash. Maybe that's, you know, almost 300 horsepower from this engine being metered out through that transmission. It just kind of works. Now on this model Telluride in particular, there are several different drive modes. I'm on record by saying I don't like the way that smart mode drives. I just feel like something called smart mode should go above and beyond, and it's just kind of a normal. So I like to keep the Telluride in comfort. And then if you really need it, you can drop down into sport for bursts or eco for highway mileage. And another thing I like, you know, I'm a fan of engine start-stop technology that cuts off the emissions while you're at a red light or something. And one of the big complaints is that it rumbles on and off and it is really annoying. And this one is really subtle and really quiet. It's a smart application of a really worthwhile technology. Speaking of technology, let's check out those blind spot cameras we were talking about earlier. If I turn on my left signal, it's got the driver's side blind spot and I can see cars coming behind me from a pretty good distance away. This is one of those features that I think will eventually become standard on cars because it just makes too much sense. When it comes to handling, again, the Telluride's main objective is to be comfortable. So while it does respond pretty quickly for an SUV this size, what it really wants to do is stay flat, stay level, and stay nice and cushy. you don't want to push it too hard through any of these turns. I would look at the Mazda CX-90 for something that's a little bit more invigorating, but this will definitely keep you comfortable through the twisties. It's got a good turning radius too. There is lots of good to discuss in the 2024 Kia Telluride, but is it all roses? Let's go over some pros and cons to figure it out. First, the pros. The 2024 Telluride is still probably the best value play you can get in a three-row crossover. There's just so much that comes in this package, even on lower trims. Also, you've just got the one V6 engine option, but that 291 horsepower is great as a standard level for the class. And finally, interior packaging is basically an A+. There is just tons of passenger and cargo space inside. As for cons, there are not a lot, but we do have a few nitpicks. One is that you only have that one powertrain and there's not a more economical option. You don't have to go all the way to hybrid or plug-in, but something with a little better MPG would be nice. Second, the Telluride is not all that nimble or athletic. There are some three-row crossovers in the segment that feel like they're getting smaller the faster you go. This isn't one of them. It's just as bricky and rock solid as it looks. And finally, the technology features in the Telluride haven't changed very much over the last few years, and it doesn't feel like there's anything really pushing the industry forward. Plus, wired smartphone integration works fine, but it would really be nice to have it wireless. All in all, Kia is riding high with the Telluride for good reason. If you're looking for a three-row family crossover, this simply has to be on your list. Well, that is all for today. Thank you so much for watching. If you liked the video, please click like and subscribe to see more just like it. And if you want to know more about the 2024 Telluride or its competitors, click the link in the description below. Until next time, thanks for watching.